Everybody, welcome to this Friday edition of the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo Rice, and my correspondents.
Double R.
Solo Dolo.
All right,
today is Friday, sir. Friday.
You tell me that after the fact, like before then you didn't say anything.
So I thought you called it. You
said no, I did not. So how was I
Mondays.
How was I supposed to know that today is Friday?
The day after Thursday?
Okay, look, first of all, I'm not going to take the brunt of this because... Labor Day weekend was this past weekend. So that threw everybody's days off. I wasn't the only one that threw everybody's days off.
No, you
so
don't.
I'm not about to take the brunt of that. You know I have a hard enough time remembering the days of the week anyway. So let alone me losing a Monday and starting the week on a Tuesday. Yeah, that's I'm not gonna take that. I'm not carrying that. Because I'm not carrying that. But so So how was everybody's Labor Day? Well, actually, let's start at the beginning because Solomon, they've only heard your voice once, so you got to do this again. So tell them who you are and all that good stuff.
I am Solo Dolo. I'm an intern out
Wait,
here.
Wait, what? You're who?
Solo Dolo, no, a.k.a.
We're not doing that. I don't know what
Solomon.
Man, his name is Solo Dolo.
We're not doing that, so I don't know how we got there.
My name's Solomon Stringer. I'm an intern here at IBNX Radio. I'm a radio personality, and I just want to tell you the facts.
Okay.
Facts.
Whatever. Okay, we'll go with that. All right, so how was everybody's Labor Day weekend?
I don't celebrate holidays, so I just went wherever the food was at.
Oh, God. Do you even cook? Do you cook?
If I have to.
Wow.
Okay, that's not really a...
If it's absolutely necessary for me to be in the kitchen, I'm in that kitchen.
I don't know exactly what that means, but okay.
So it means if somebody else cook, I'm at their house.
But can you cook?
Yeah, I can cook.
Like, because I can cook.
Oatmeal
and minute rice don't count.
So that's why I did parentheses. For me, I can cook, but I can't cook.
So like can you make breakfast?
I can make breakfast.
Can you make a dinner?
It depends on what that dinner is.
TV dinner.
Like what? No, TV dinner is fine. I won't do that anymore. Nobody does that. That's not a thing. But, I mean, like, I can cook, but I eat like a kid, so I don't really have to cook, per se. Like, I don't eat food. The only thing I actually like to eat that I really should learn how to cook is pork chops. I really should learn how to cook pork chops because I really do like pork chops. But outside of that, the stuff that I eat, I can get out the ready-to-cook aisle from Walmart and throw it in a pot, put water with it, and I'm good. So I don't have to cook.
Yeah, and pork chops not that hard to cook.
Everybody keeps saying that, but if you don't cook, they are. Like, the thought of... I promised the fire department I would not try to cook again because it didn't end well. And, yeah, it didn't end well. So
we're just going to leave that story where it's at.
it just didn't end well. So I don't really want to, you know, get into that. But, you know, it's one of those things.
I can cook enough. Like, I can cook enough. I'm not, like... I ain't making a table like this full of food. It's 2 to 3 people.
But you
people.
Cook, like, chicken and stuff like that.
Nah, chicken is... I'm a beast with the chicken because that's my favorite. Like anything grilled, fried,
so
baked.
Stereotypical. The one thing you really can cook well is chicken.
Chicken, so macaroni and cheese. My macaroni and cheese is decent. Like my mom, my aunt, whatever they be putting in their macaroni and cheese, I need to find out what it is.
I don't.
You don't like macaroni and cheese?
I
say you don't like macaroni and cheese on the radio right now.
I do like macaroni and cheese, but it took me some years to like macaroni and cheese.
I've been liking macaroni and cheese since I was a kid.
No, I don't. My family's going to crucify me. But I don't eat Southern food, and I'm from the Deep South. I don't eat Southern food. Like, you put greens in front of me, and you can get a nasty look. I don't really like chicken like that. I don't eat Southern food like that. So I
just
now. That sounds
like a bad experience.
No, I just, okay.
Like, one of your aunties couldn't cook, and she was the one that made Thanksgiving. At her house, so you knew you had to eat it.
No, I the reality is I was a picky child. And on both sides of my family, my in-laws would cook separate food just for me. So on my mom's side, my Aunt Rose would cook. She knew I like, everybody knew I like rice, ironically. So they would make, on my mom's side, Aunt Rose would make me rice, and she knew I love yeast rolls. So that was only for Ricky. Nobody touches it. That's only for Ricky. Everybody knew it. On my dad's side, my grandma knew I love brown rice with like meat in it. So that's what she would make. She'd make a whole pot just for me. So I didn't have to eat all the other stuff because they would make separate food.
Chicken, though.
It wasn't chicken. It wasn't chicken.
See, we were just talking about safe spaces.
It wasn't chicken.
You basically had your chicken in your rice in a safe space.
It was not chicken.
It's all right.
But it was not chicken. But I digress. So anyway, let's get into it. So as we know, the hurricane has been kind of running through Hurricane Dorian. Which I was impressed with the name. I was like, oh.
They got to start with these names. It feel like they just,
Dorian.
It's like they be in people's neighborhood. Like, what's your name? Dorian. Okay. Hey, write that one down. That's a good one.
We're doing Dorian. Okay. All right. So the death toll is now up to 30. But there are still hundreds of people missing. So more body bags and coolers are being brought in. Officials are warning people to prepare for unimaginable information on the death toll. The U.S. Coast Guard has rescued 201 people, and a British naval ship is giving out food and water, clearing debris from the streets.
That's the Bahamas, right?
Yeah. Meanwhile, in North Carolina coast and Virginia, they're getting rain, storm surges, and strong winds. At least 5 people in the USA have been killed, and it is now a Category 1 hurricane. It blew by South Carolina, which is where I'm from, thank God. It's so funny. I call my mom. I'm like, okay, so mom, yeah, I'm putting mom on blast. I was like, okay, so when y'all leaving? She was like, you know, your dad's not leaving. And I was like, we seriously doing this so dad's not leaving? She's like, no, we're not leaving. I was like, oh my God. And I had a flashback to Hurricane Hugo in like 93 when my dad was determined to not leave and we stayed in the house for Hurricane Hugo and it was just crazy. But I digress. So yeah, it's now a Category 1 and it's really in certain areas just like wind and rain. But what is this comment that Trump made about he didn't know what a Category 5 was or something?
Yeah, so my man's is,
really,
when they asked him about the hurricanes, that's right. It's not the first time, because he did this last year. Was it Harvey last year?
I think it was Harvey.
I had never heard of a Category 5 hurricane. I didn't know those existed. Because you know he doing this all the time. And somebody made the joke that only people that do this is people that eat their food like this, like children. I didn't
really
know.
Really?
I just want to know why he got to do, what is this?
I mean, because
it really looked like he throwing up gang signs.
I have to get my attention, my crowd's attention, and this is the only thing that they need my hand cues to.
I mean, I'm not going to say anything because I talk with my hands a lot, so I can't say
but
anything.
But your hand's not simultaneously doing the same thing at the same time.
And you have a higher understanding and more vocabulary than Donald Trump, Blake.
Okay, well, that's neither here nor there. But I'm just saying, I don't.
The man said he the president of the United States. He is almost 80 years old and said that he has never heard of Category 5
I mean, when you
hurricane.
Rich, like, probably won't hurt.
Okay, so my question is, have we not gotten to a place where we establish that Trump literally just says things just to say things, start conversation? I just really don't believe that a sitting president, is that clueless. I just don't believe that. Not anymore. At one time, yeah, he just could be that special. But at this point, I feel like he says things for shock value, which is ironic considering the fact that because he says so much, there should be no more shock value. But it still works. So I really believe he's just doing this stuff now for kicks and giggles. Because it dazzles the masses. So I'll stand up in front of the podium, the White House podium, and say, I'd have never heard of a Category 5 hurricane. There's no way on God's green earth that's true. You're just saying things for shock value at this point. That's the only thing I can believe at this point. I can't believe anything else. So, yeah, I'm not about to go with that. That's foolishness.
And you say there's been 34 Category 5 hurricanes to hit our coast since 1924. And there were 5 last year. Yeah, it's bad.
You said that he doesn't understand. You said that he said that, but on Wednesday he defended his administration's reallocation of money from the FEMA Federal Emergency Management Agency to address the influx of migrants at the southern border, even as Hurricane Dorian approached the U.S. mainland. So, like, even though he hasn't heard of it, or these hurricanes or whatever, why did he cut
FEMA?
Why did he cut FEMA?
Because he's not the first president to do it. That started with like Bush, but we know like FEMA be jugging. How you raise $100 million in like 2-3 weeks, and you only giving people like sack lunches?
It has to get spread.
I mean, packs. I mean, it still has to be spread across whatever happens. We have another natural disaster tomorrow, and it all comes from FEMA. Like the recovery efforts come from FEMA.
But so we're talking about hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars.
Yeah,
that
but
they
think
raise.
About how fast that can be depleted one full state. Like. Well, that's a lot of money for one state.
Like with Houston. So like that was their state gets money in particular to help like coastal cities, their cities get money to prepare for something like that. So say if a hurricane is to hit like somewhere like Savannah or something, close to the coast, if a hurricane hit that city, their city they have the funds to say, okay, we sustain $300 million worth of damage. We have to implement a plan to get this stuff rebuilt, to drain the water out of the city, to do this, do this, do this. What FEMA does is FEMA is supposed to provide the essential items and housings to cover that, because if all your cribs is destroyed, where you going to stay at? Well, you got that kind of money, and we talking about like years. You do know they get years and years of money every year. Like they get years of money every year. So what a company will earn in a year, they get a couple times that a year. Just raising that. It ain't been nothing like that since Houston. And that was earlier this year. And then Cuba and Puerto Rico. But at the end of the day, those are territories of the U.S. So you got to front the bill for that anyway. FEMA doesn't necessarily do, like, we've never heard of FEMA really doing that. It took 4 years for people to get their FEMA checks from Katrina. 4 years. So you're talking about, like, y'all supposed to cover, they displaced the city. So you're probably talking about 15,000 to 25,000 people. Y'all got the money. It took 4 years for you to get 25,000 people money.
Yeah, but here's my.
Even though they had the money.
Yeah, but. That's a lot of people, though.
But it's documented that you were given the money. They were given the money in particular to do that.
Yeah, but here's the problem with that. It's the same thing we see now. Whenever, out of sight, out of mind. So whenever there's money just sitting there and something more immediate or something more pressing happens, they pull from what they can't see. So it becomes, oh, we need infrastructure. The roads just caved. Where are we going to get this money from? Oh, well, we use the infrastructure money because we've never really had to use infrastructure money for infrastructure because it kind of lasts for a while. So we use that money to do something else. I feel like it's the same thing with disaster relief. It's like with Atlanta and snow stuff. I'm sure they were given money for natural disasters, which we would have never fathomed. We would have snowgetting when we did a couple of years ago. So they used that money for something else. I don't know if it was a pride parade. I don't know if Kasim Reed wanted to add a part to the airport. They used that money because if they can't fathom us having to use to appropriate that money for what it's appropriated for, we use it for something else. So when it happens out of the blue, the money's no longer there. So I'm inclined to believe that's what happened with FEMA. They had used that money for other stuff because we'd never seen anything like that majorly in the last couple of years. So they used it for other stuff. So you need those 4 years to put that money back.
But
I think that's what we do.
In Atlanta, I don't think it was that. I think that you're giving, like you remember when before AT&T was doing like rollover minutes? You're given a certain amount of minutes for the month. If you don't use those minutes go away like vacation time. So but not like that the money will go away, but you have to use that money for something related to the thing that you were giving the money for. So if you're giving money for infrastructure and you don't use it to pave roads, what else would you use it for? Sanitation, sewage, street lights. Why is it mad new streetlights in Atlanta when it's holes in the street?
Holes the understatement. What we have now are like craters in these roads.
And I'm like, I'm talking like on the highway. Like when you see a hole on the highway, that's a little bit different. They rebuilt the bridge in 4 months. That 85 thing when they said it exploded, it didn't explode. Like, it didn't caught on fire.
We saw fire. I mean, it was.
It caught on fire, but it was under the bridge, and it took 4 months for them to get. You did that to one bridge, and now they're building a new highway. For what?
Where?
On 75, right there at 285 and 400. They're building a they're trying to create a new spaghetti junction where there's already a spaghetti junction on top of that. So I'm gonna put a spaghetti on top of the spaghetti for no reason. Why am I creating new exits for the highway? Like, I can see why they did it for the Braves Stadium, because they built a whole new exit ramp to let you off right at the stadium. What's the point of doing that on the highway? You ain't gonna let me off right at my job. Like, I work at the Kings and Queens Tower, so we're gonna give you a junction to get off right at the parking deck, so you could just buzz yourself in. No, but that's what they spend the money for, and they barely got up the columns for it.
Yeah, I don't understand. Like, there's construction literally everywhere as it pertains to 285, because even right by the Sandy Springs exit, which I think is exit 25, there's construction there. So I don't understand exactly what we're doing at this point. Like, what exactly are we doing? Are we expanding 285? Because it's already big. Are we expanding 400? Are we adding something new that will go between 285 and 400? What are we doing exactly? Because I'm confused.
I think they do stuff like that so people don't be out of job. So in order for you not to be out of job, we're just going to create something that we know going to take a long time and get a job.
Let's not act like the traffic in Atlanta is not god-awful. So, I mean, if we've had some feasible solution, and that's what we're building, fine. But if we're just doing something just to do it, to create jobs, I can't say that's not fine, too. I mean, we need the job creation. So, if we have the finances that's been allocated for it, is it really a lose? I mean, it's a win-win.
I mean, you're talking about a million people on the highway at the same time. Like,
I mean, it's an inconvenience, especially at night, because now they've got this thing where they want to do construction.
And they'll
now
shut down a whole two, three lanes.
I almost had an accident last night. They shut down three of them, and I couldn't even see. It was night, so I couldn't even see when they put the little thing with the arrow. So I almost ran into it. I'm just like, okay, why did you not warn me, like, 2 miles over the road that I was going to have to change like you normally do? I'm not really understanding.
And then if you got to get off at the exit, they got the cones. So you got to drive all the way through. It's dumb, but that it just show you, like, they allocate money for certain things, and then you use it for something else, and then when something real happen, we don't got the funds. FEMA be having the money. It be the state that be saying they don't have them. Well, we don't have the money. That's what City Houston said. We don't have the money to cover this. How? When you were given, every single state is giving money for disaster relief.
But like you said, if it's on a fiscal cycle, that means it gets reappropriated. So it's like what you said. It's like if with the radio station, if I'm given a budget for marketing and that budget is $3,000, and at the end of my fiscal cycle, consistently for the last three cycles, I've used $1,500, eventually you're going to say, okay, well, you've done this consistently for 3 months. So you clearly don't need a $2,500 budget for marketing because you've been doing it with $1,500. It could be the same thing for the states. Okay, well, we're allocating infrastructure money for $2 million. Well, you haven't done any infrastructure repairs in the last 3 years, so clearly you can get by without it. So why don't we just cut that down to $1 million? We can take the other $1 million and reallocate it to children's health. I don't know, but that's kind of the ideology behind business. So it's not a far-fetched ideology.
And they fit the corners is like that's.
It's not really cutting corners because you're
in business, but that's what it is, though.
Well, but technically, and this is what I warn people about when it comes to numbers. Technically, numbers will paint a picture that may not necessarily be true. So just because you've managed to not fix infrastructure for the last 3 years doesn't mean that your bridges aren't falling apart and you haven't been putting together a plan for 3 years, because it really takes that long because you have a state that's big. But the numbers will say, okay, well, they haven't used this money in 3 years, so the likelihood of them using this money is not very high. So even if we don't deplete that money that's been delegated for infrastructure, but we just downsize it and give them $1 million, they should still be fine, because clearly they're not doing it every year. The numbers painted that picture. Doesn't necessarily mean that nobody's paying attention to it or there's not something being done in that particular avenue.
And that's the thing that's so different with Georgia. Like, there's the mayor of City of Atlanta, and then like the mayor of East Point, which is down the street, and then you got like the mayor of Brookhaven, which is up the street, and then like DeKalb County has like a commissioner, a mayor, and a CEO. Like, How does a city have a CEO? I'm confused. So you got all these people that make decisions for a place that's up the street from the Capitol. You drive down the street, you in a whole nother city, and they got a CEO? DeKalb County has a CEO.
Damn, but then you
what is the CEO? Who is the CEO of Atlanta? Like, what's that person's name?
Well, I think you get into title the names of positions. So I don't. It may not be called the CEO of Atlanta. It's probably called something else. Like the you hear some of the craziest terms, and you start looking at the municipal.
But that's where the money going.
Stuff, but you gotta see what they do, because you really gotta think about what the job of a mayor and a governor is. They really play more to politics and legislation. So having a CEO would be somebody that does the direct on the ground operations of the actual city itself. So I could get there.
But governors is for the state. So if your governor got to talk to 75 mayors, I don't want to talk to all y'all.
So your city get a budget. It's kind of one of those things. Because I understand politics. I get it, because, you know, you got to have your figurehead to all they do is they do the legislation, they talk the talk, and for everybody else, somebody has to be on the ground running the operations.
And so, that's the thing about state, that I when I watch a lot of these interviews, a lot of these people, like even with the presidential candidates, like when they start talking about like Puerto Rico and Cuba and things that affect America, that's the number one thing that they say, that it's so many people involved. How can you get, it's just like with the campaigns. If you got 24 people on stage, everybody's saying something different. How many people are on the same page to discuss the one problem? Like that's always my argument with like Bernie. They ask Bernie one question and he'll say, you know what, I'm gonna get to that. But let me say about education. Bernie. He asked you if you was hungry. Bernie, are you hungry? We're going to get to that. But let me let you know that young people, one day, like, Bernie, come on now.
But he's telling his campaign, too. Like, he got his own message that he's trying to promote, too. So he's probably not trying to hear all of that.
And you
got to
remember, when they're on stage, they're trying to get as many of their focal points in as they can. So any space that they can have, if you ask me a question and you say, okay, are you hungry, Bernie? That's an opportunity for me to talk about lunch reform. Well, I'm not hungry, but there are 50 million kids that are hungry, and it's like open-ended questions. And even though they're not asked open-ended questions intentionally, if they see the space, they got to take it, because you may not get asked a question to facilitate what you're trying to actually say.
But it shows you also, like, what politics look like in real life. The reason why a lot of people can't get a lot of things done is because of this. This is what it looked like. You got 24 people. Or if you look at, like, state senates or, like, the House for Georgia. Mm-hmm. If it's that many people sitting in a room, you're talking about 400 people sitting in a room, and we got to discuss what's going on in a state with maybe 7.5 million people. Imagine what it looked like in New York. It's 14 million people live in a city. How can we discuss getting things done with the amount of people in the city? And they make the decisions. A lot of these people don't participate in that conversation. So you just got a bunch of people that go that represent you to have that conversation.
That's a good place to segue. All right, so a couple of days ago, CNN hosted a marathon of climate crisis town halls. Yeah. 10 Democratic presidential hopefuls over 7 hours laid out their plans to save the planet. Some of the big takeaways. I was really blown away. Kamala Harris says she would ditch the Senate filibuster to pass the Green New Deal.
Mm-hmm.
Julian Castro pushed for the new civil rights legislation to address environmental racism. Beto O'Rourke said he would push to use federal funds to help people in flood-prone areas move to higher ground. And Pete Buttigieg believes fighting climate change might be harder than winning World War II. President Trump and others in the GOP mocked the candidates via Twitter, of course, and that says CNN political analyst Stephen Collison is why running on the climate crisis is something of a risk for Democrats, while going big on climate is the price of entry into their presidential race, it's yet to be proven as a shrewd general election strategy. Thoughts?
You want to start?
I'm not certain on that last part, because Donald Trump, like, his election campaign was, you're beep this, you're beep that, I'm better than you. And people was like, yeah, I'm cheering for it. So it's like, you know, he can mock you because it's like, that's what he did to get elected, and that's what he's going to do to get reelected. And not to also mention, like, he got funds to fund the border wall. So if the border wall is complete by the time
Which brings me to my next point. Where do we even stand on this wall? Like, all of a sudden, nothing. It was all we heard about, and then nothing. Is it being built? Did we stop? Where are we at with that? Like, I've heard nothing about anybody out there that works for Border Patrol. Please, you can write on the timeline, the feed for the station. I would really love to know where we stand with the border wall right now, because I've heard nothing about it.
I heard Senator Ted Cruz was drafting a bill, like he was one of the key signers to use El Chapo's money to fund the border wall.
Wait, what? Okay, what we're not about to do is play this game. Because we can use El Chapo money for so much more. Yeah, so right. much more.
It's funny because when you're talking about a couple hundred million dollars, because that's what they said they found.
A billion.
Like,
a couple billion dollars.
That's what they said they found. Like, that's how much
how
money.
How do you just sit around with $1 billion? Like, I can't even imagine.
Well, when you charge somebody the amount of money that they claim, because they're saying, like, he stole this money from America. Because he pushed drugs.
I'm about to say he's a drug dealer, so how do you...
Yeah, but he also testified in court that he was hired by somebody from... That's the thing about America. Nobody likes to take the blame for what they did. So you see them, like, come out with them. That documentary about El Chapo kind of gave it away. And that was his son telling the story. Now, we don't know where bro at, but we know where his dad at. Like, they say his son got killed. I don't believe that these folks just disappear like this. But for you to tell me that you're going to take a couple billion dollars and pay somebody, like, you're going to fund the building of a wall to separate a country.
Ironically, though, Donald Trump did say Mexico was going to pay for it. So, you know, in some strange
but
way,
is Chapo from Mexico or yeah, is he from is. Guatemala?
He's
I was going to make an ignorant statement, so I'm not even going to say what I was going to say.
I think he's from Mexico.
I don't know. Like, we got the Googles. But if he is from Mexico, cool. If he not, that's a little funny.
What?
Because Trump think that Guatemala and Honduras is Mexico. And if that's our president, what makes this thing so funny.
His let's be fair.
He said he don't believe in climate change.
Are you surprised? It's something he won't have to deal with, because you getting the climate change.
Georgia had a snowstorm.
Yeah, let's...
It snowed here before, but Georgia had like an ice storm.
Yeah, snowgetting.
I'm sorry, he's Mexican, and I was wrong. He didn't have a $2 billion net worth. He had $14 billion.
He worth way more money than that, but that's what they could find.
Again, where do you put $14 billion if it's not going in the bank? Where do you put it?
In the dirt.
You can't put it under a mattress. So where are you putting $14 billion at? You can't expect it under a mattress.
For him, because our governments and our bank system isn't the same. So they probably did a lot of digging, and they probably was watching this bread.
Again, but I mean, what is... Exactly. We're not talking about 2000.
But we're talking about a man that went to jail in Armani. They locked him up, and he had on Armani.
I mean, he has $14 billion. You sound surprised.
Yeah, but if I go to jail in Armani, like, you better know I got the bread like that. But I don't think they just selling Armani in Mexico like that.
I mean, he can have it shipped. I mean, you can buy it from Amazon. I mean, really?
You got $14 billion. You can do whatever you want.
Exactly. I mean, for that much money, you will pay $100 for shipping?
If I got $14 billion, I can also hide the fact that I probably got $100 billion.
I mean, again, where do you put $14? I mean, do you put it in a cave that you're just kind of sitting, sleeping on money? $14 billion?
That's always been the question.
You can put it in the Cayman Islands.
Yeah, that's always been the question about somebody transferring their money to the Caymans. The Cayman Islands isn't that big.
Okay, we got to get into something before I get
But this you. Climate change thing is funny.
Okay, so this, I'm a segue because this concerns me. So apparently, Lyft is in the news because they have rape and assault allegations mounting against them from sexual, they have a sexual predator crisis.
Lyft and Uber. Both.
I know, but Uber's, I don't think it's as new as Lyft. I think this is new for Lyft, because I've never heard Lyft having these issues. We know Uber has these kind of issues. Uber's older. But for Lyft to have these issues, especially when you've had the opportunity to learn from the mistakes of Uber, I'm kind of thrown away with this. So apparently they've been alleged that they're mishandling what amounts to a sexual predator crisis. There was a case filed on Wednesday on behalf of 14 women who say they were sexually assaulted by their drivers in 2018 and 2019. Five say they were raped, including one woman who was blind. Jesus. Only one of the 14 women whose stories underpinned the claim says she was told by the company that her driver was removed from the app. Others have worried that their drivers may have kept contracting with Lyft even after the women reported to them, to the company, or the police. Gladys Aker, this is a USA Today article. Gladys Aker, 40, a mother of four, told USA Today she was kidnapped for hours by a driver who teetered between professionals of love and threats of violence before raping her. Months after she'd filed a police report, she says the investigators on her criminal case told her the man was still driving for Lyft.
I'm confused. Like, did she call the police? Because if you get raped and you only reported to Lyft, I'm confused.
Well, I think she
and
did.
And I don't believe you.
I think it said that she reported to, she called the police, and I guess in the process of doing the report and everything, I guess Lyft was contacted because he was a contractor with Lyft. So then Lyft, I guess, responded and said that he was still driving for them. I guess my question is, and I'm not being insensitive.
People get raped at school.
I'm not being insensitive because I drive for Lyft and Uber. So I'm not being insensitive, but I'm just trying to understand, what else can they do? They give you the license plate. Well, I guess.
People get raped at school. People get raped in cars. People get raped in church. Catholic church been raping little boys. It's one of those things, like, it's becoming one of those things where it's becoming overlooked. Like, you remember when Me Too first started? It was like a thing. It was like a thing. And then when you realize that 60% of the women that have accused people of doing something to them, when you realize they're lying, and then they come out and say, I mean, he didn't necessarily rape me, but like, I felt like
that's
it.
That's not everybody.
Or it's just bad.
Or when it's proven, like, I can name a couple of cases. The Freddie Gibbs case from a couple years ago. He in Amsterdam. Girl come to his show, said that she had a dream that he raped her. A dream. He stayed in jail for 6 months for a girl said that she had a dream that he raped her.
A dream. How you even indict
my
somebody?
My point
on that?
Exactly. But he in Amsterdam.
You can indict a ham sandwich.
So. Like he in Amsterdam. Really? Yeah. Or the Anzis Ansari. We went on a date. You came back to the crib. You gave me the toppy. You gave it to me. And then turned around and said, I felt uncomfortable. I feel like he didn't realize my signs.
In this particular case, what are you saying?
You took your clothes off? Yes. You took your panties off? Yes. You took your bra off? Yes. You got butt naked? Yes. But I was uncomfortable. What?
I mean, you.
Hold on. What?
You got to please it, man. If you don't please it right. You got to hit whip. You got to face whip.
But there's always been a fine line.
Louis C.K. You came in my office. I start pleasuring myself. You stayed in the chair and watched me. He made me uncomfortable. He just masturbated right in front of me. You watched it, the whole thing? Yeah. I mean, he climaxed right in front of me. So you telling me that you watched the dude pleasure himself in front
of
you?
Was it her boss, though?
What was I supposed to do? Like,
was it her boss?
You could have walked out.
Was it her boss?
No, it was multiple women that said that they work with him.
But was he their boss?
I don't know.
I just don't want to get fired.
It don't matter.
It does matter. Look.
Who going to pay the bill?
He hit him with the Matt Liner when you walk in my... what's his name? The dude from ABC that got fired? Matt Lauer, that had the button, the lock the door. He ain't hit him with that.
What?
Yeah, Matt Lauer had the. They said that and he wasn't the only one. The one of the ABC executives, they got it where you walk in the door and they hit a little button and it locks the door like you can't get out.
Why is that even legal?
That's why you think he got fired.
R. Kelly.
Lost 100. Lost 100 million.
Okay, what they were saying.
A lot of 100 million. But it's just, it's one of those things, like, times is becoming, it's becoming like I could point the finger, and people are starting to realize, like, just because you point the finger don't mean you ain't lying.
Yeah, but, okay, so the question specifically with this Lyft debacle is, as somebody who does drive for Lyft and Uber, they've taken safety measurements. Now, granted, I think Uber is the one that really started coming down hard about people's records. So it got to a place with Uber now, if you have certain types of records, I can't remember exactly what on your in your past, you can't drive for Uber.
If you got a felony, so you can't drive for Uber.
Most of them shifted over to Lyft. But my thing is, at this point, they give you the license plate number. They give you the picture. They give you the stars and comments. I didn't realize they did that until somebody got in my car and it was like, oh my God, you know, you've done X amount of rides in this amount of time. And, you know, people say they love you. I'm like, how do you know that? Yeah. She's like, because we can see all that. You can see all that. So yeah. They can see all these things at this point, and they're tracking the satellites on your phone. So I don't understand what else can they do at this point. Like, but I'm not being insensitive, but what else can they do? Like,
all the things you just listed, like that can't help me in the moment when I'm in the back of your car.
But what else do you expect me to do? What else can I do?
My thing is,
some people are just creeps.
This is the question. Did he rape you and drop you off? And that's not me being insensitive. What? That's a real question. He raped you and dropped you off at home.
What does that even mean? So if he did that, what does that even mean?
Why would you do that?
Why would I drop you off?
Right.
Why would I take you home? Because now I know where you stay. I could come back for seconds. Like... You telling me that you got raped in a Lyft and you call a Lyft? Cause that's what this sound like.
She called the police, and I think in the process of filing the report, somebody called Lyft afterwards. I think she called the police.
But with what Lyft is really good at, that Uber is really trash at, is an investigation. Lyft is really good at investigations. Like I had when I was driving for Lyft, I had a lady, her kid peed in my car. Ew. Yeah, it was like real pee.
What is that?
It was real pee.
Fake pee.
So I don't know. I mean, I think people can accuse people of urinating in their car, and they'll send you a $250 like the very next day to get your car clean. So Liv told me, they said, no, you take your car, clean your car, and continue your rides, but take your car to a designated Lyft service station so they can check the evidence. So I took the pictures, I took a little video of me cleaning the car, whatever. And they have a test where they can spray something on your car, like when the police looking for blood and urine and deer, they have something they can spray on your seat. So if you accuse somebody of peeing in your car, they can test it. And if it's not urine, you got to pay Lyft back. So they'll investigate. But for that many people to accuse somebody of raping them, and like you made at home, that's a little weird.
Okay, so let me add. As soon as my computer starts doing something, let me add to that, because there were some things in it that go to what you were saying. The question,
because they're just allegations, and the problem is when you accuse somebody of something that egregious, and you're wrong, you need to go to jail.
Forever. I want to bet it.
I want to get you life sentence.
All right, so here's one. One woman says she was raped by a Lyft driver who followed her back to her hotel room, then stole her phone and added a $25 tip to the ride. Another said she was... It's not funny, but it's funny. Like, how stupid do you have to be? So you're going to follow me back to my room, steal my phone, then add a $25 tip from my phone to your ride. How stupid can you be? Another woman says she woke up in the backseat of the car to find her driver on top of her pants unzipped. One driver was accused by two women who shared a Lyft ride home after a night out in Chicago. They said the driver molested one of them at her front door, then got back in the car, drove the second woman home, and molested her there.
So wait, What was the second girl doing while she was getting molested?
Did she call the police?
Well, I think they said after a night out. Okay, I don't usually drive on weekends at night because they really be out of it. Like,
did
they
anybody
get your car,
call the police?
And on a sidebar, let me just say this to people that have friends and y'all go out. It is not cool to get drunk, you stay sober, your friends get drunk, and you put your friend in a Lyft or a Uber and tell the Uber or Lyft driver to make sure they get home. That is not cool. Like, that's how stuff like this can actually happen. Because I've had that happen. Like, if somebody put a drunk person in my backseat, and, you know, I'm a caring person, so I just want to make sure they get home. But if you put them in the backseat of a creep, you setting them up for stuff like this. Like, come on, people. I understand that we are humans, but not everybody's a good human. But on that note, we're going to take a break. And when we come back from break, we will probably have our guest today, Miss Victoria Allen. So stick around on the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice.
this thing.
That's all thing. All right, buddy. It's Friday edition of Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo Rice, and my correspondent,
Double R.
And the new intern,
Solomon Stringer.
Solo Dolo.
Right. We are not doing that. That's not a thing.
We're going to make it a thing.
That is not a thing.
Here on IBX. Solo Dolo.
Oh, my God. That's not a thing. All right. So when we left, because the feed was buzzing about this whole Lyft and rape. I don't want to call it rape culture. I won't say that.
That's what
that's kind of what they're alluding to.
It's like accusation culture.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure you can prove these things. So it's not that I don't think these ladies are lying. The question just becomes, my question for everybody is, what more can Lyft do? That's my question.
Here's what you do. Okay, I know Lyft is...
This better be a good answer.
It is a good answer. They're burning through billions, but honestly, you need to have yourself like a beefy type enforcer in the car, like to make sure...
Did I tell you this better be good?
It is good.
That is not good. I don't want...
Because an enforcer can know, okay, she's good, nothing happened, I was there.
Like, or he could join in... And then you get raped by two people.
Get a camera. Make them wear a camera 24/7.
Instead of being so happy about giving people them Lyft lights, you need to put a camera on it. And it needs to be on as long as you're on the app. So every time you're driving, there's a camera in your car. Every time. You get in the car, you cut that amp on. If you're on the app and your amp isn't on, you can't pick up no Lyft. You can't do no Lyft.
I mean, I guess. I mean, I'm thinking about myself.
Unless it's somebody that's just raping on camera.
I mean, I guess that would be... Well, that's what saved... I mean, a lot of the debacles that you see from Uber or Lyft are usually captured because individuals, drivers, have their own dash cams. I don't really want one, but... I mean, again, my question is, what else can they do? But at the same token, some of these stories do sound a little outlandish. Like the story that I read about the lady, the two people, the guy raped two ladies riding, the guy rapes one of the ladies, drops her off, drops the other lady off, and rapes her. Like, how do we get there? Because you got to have your phone to book this ride. So your phone has to be with you. So how do we get there?
And you watched your friend get raped. Why would you even stay in the car?
Why? I don't. That's a long time. Dude.
I don't get it. I'm trying to. You want to be compassionate, but I don't get how we get to some of these places because you got to have your phone to book the ride. So
these not black women, right? Right.
We really can go there.
We really can go there. I make it racial real fast. black women.
We are not doing that
because black women not just fit to go down like all week.
Like, but, yeah, okay.
He raped my friend and then took me home.
So let's take this another way. Maybe there's another problem that we're presented with, and that problem is alcohol culture. The fact that you think it's okay, we should not be your designated driver per se, meaning we should not be held responsible for you getting to where you're going if you're already inebriated when you get in the car.
I'm not your designated driver. Uber drivers ready to fight you right now. Because especially in, you got to think about it, football cities. Football season in Atlanta, you know how much money you gonna make down there.
Yeah, but I also want to bear the burden of having to make sure that you get where you're going when somebody puts you in my car inebriated. And then you wake up, get home, and you don't know what happened. And for your first instinct is to blame me.
That's why I don't do Uber no more. Because I picked the girl up, her and her friend, and she popped a pill in my car and kicked a hole in my seat.
What?
And I put her out. But I was at her house. And she lived on a hill. I didn't drive up the hill. I pulled into the little cul-de-sac and was like, yo, you just... And then she threw up in my car, got out the car and called the police. I ain't even leave the neighborhood. I pulled up to the stop sign. I called the police. I had 8 police cars show up.
What?
It's 2 white girls. White girl said that she was scared because I got loud with her and I put her out of my car. You right. You kicked a hole in my leather seat.
You about demeanor. Like, you have this demeanor. Like, now you sitting on the show with a hoodie on and glasses. It's about demeanor.
Yo, you kicked a hole and threw up in my car.
And popped a pill.
Okay, so we're going to take a quick break really quickly, and then we're going to come back, pay some bills, go on break real quick. So stick around the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo D. Rice.
Yeah, baby, where y'all deal with?
Hey,
We come through a lot of things, you know. So what happened to you? You make one little mistake, you want done us.
New Jasmine, let's go.
If I had you back in my world, I would prove that I could be a better girl. Oh, if you let me back in, I would show never, never, never let you go again. Hey, baby, ooh, I was so foolish to ever leave your side. Ooh, searching for what was right before my eyes. It was me who didn't realize till it was gone, but now I know I need you in my life. Boy, I need you better than my heart beats, better than the food I eat, better than the air I breathe.
Everybody, we are back on this Friday edition of the Leadership Blend with your host Ricardo Wright and my correspondent Double R.
Solomon Solo Dolo.
Oh my God, that is
Solo
not a,
Dolo.
That is not a thing.
Y'all got to excuse
that
me.
That is not a thing.
I was watching a very, very interesting video on YouTube.
I don't even want to know what it is.
What we were talking about, man? These folks is funny.
All right, so right now in the studio we have our guest for today. I'm going to let her introduce herself, tell everybody your name, and tell everybody what you do.
Hello, I'm Victoria Allen, and I'm a children's book author. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah? Hand clap, a little something. Okay, snaps. I'll take that.
It's on the computer, Keith. It's right there on the computer. A virtual DJ that says applause.
It's okay.
He's fired. He's fired. Yeah, I mean, you can do it now. It's okay.
I don't think it's too late.
I mean, it's never too late for a lot of stuff. Thank you.
All right, so before we get into you, we're talking about rate and lift. And I read a couple of stories, one of which that is the most disturbing was two women who I'm assuming were inebriated, got into a lift. The lift driver raped one of the women, took her home, took the other lady home and raped her.
Wow.
And we're all trying to figure out how does that happen.
Falling asleep.
Nope.
Okay, you ready with the no bomb. Knew what I was about to say. Why you say no?
Falling asleep?
Yeah, in an Uber.
Nope.
You never fell asleep in a bed?
Oh, that's left. I drive Uber lifts at times.
You've left.
But how do you know?
Okay, put your hand right here. Put your hand right here.
What you got about with?
You feel that?
Oh, it's hot.
Would you feel that if you were asleep?
No! All
right.
If you sleep, you feel everything when you sleep.
Now, if I rub my hand up your arm, would you feel that if you sleep?
It depends on how hard I sleep. Some people sleep light. Some people...
Yeah. He raped her friend while she was in the car.
Okay. So they were both in the back seat.
They were in the back seat.
They were both in the back seat.
They were in the back seat.
He raped the friend
Okay.
Raped the one girl.
Okay.
And took the girl home.
The one he raped. He took her home.
Then went to the other girl house, dropped her off, and then raped her too, okay. And then left.
Okay, I didn't understand all that. There was a lot going on. That's what it sounds
like. You got to think about the scene of the crime. Like,
I don't believe
you're talking about a back seat, and we don't know how big the driver was.
I don't believe
you climb into the back seat, rape one girl, take her home.
While the other one's there.
While the other one has to be sitting there.
I don't
believe it. Worst case scenario, he takes her out and put her in the front seat. So he has the whole back seat. That's the worst case scenario. Oh, that's the best case scenario. Then you take her home. The one you just raped, you take her home. And then you take the other one home. This time, you didn't rape her in the car. You go in her house and rape her.
You need a key.
And then $25.
I'm sure she has her keys, but I'm assuming both these ladies are inebriated.
That's a lot going on. So what happens after this? All of this, then what? They reported?
Well, these were stories that were compiled with a lawsuit that, or a growing problem that Liz seems to have with almost a rape culture. So the question becomes, my question is, what else can Lyft do? They give you the driver's name. They give you the license plate. They give you the make and model of the car. They give you the reviews. They give you all of this. What else can they do at this point?
And another thing.
That is true.
I mean, but everybody, who says I want a camera on my dashboard?
Without the criminal aspect, like without the criminal
so
cases
about you.
Coming
I'm
down.
I'm just saying.
Without the criminal cases coming down, like in addition to the lawsuit, How is their work going to stand if, like, nobody who's, like, the Lyft driver is prosecuted for criminal charges, serving criminal time? Like, oh, you raped me, this is proven, this is fact. How does their word have merit, like, if all they have to do is allege, oh, he allegedly did this?
Right,
like,
and then you remember last year, the one of the Lyft drivers accused one of her riders of groping her. That's what happened to, what's the football player? It happened to Ezekiel Elliott. It happened not Ezekiel Elliott. The quarterback from the quarterback from Tampa Bay. Jameis Winston. The driver said that he was in the car with one of his partners, and then she said that he groped her from the back seat. So you can accuse somebody of groping you from the back seat, but you can't prove it. And they dropped the case. She got a little check, probably a little 10 piece.
What is a 10 piece?
10,000. They probably shot her a little 10 piece and he got suspended for 3 games. The problem is that the credibility of the person that you accuse, your credibility not worth more than theirs. Like, it's not worth more. The only thing that made his case different is because somebody got raped at his school and he was there and he ain't testify. But she said he did it. He wasn't even in the room. And it become one of those things like, is it rape or did you just give it up and you ain't like it?
Well, now I'm curious about the protocol. So in the case, when this happens, is the protocol to call the police first or is the protocol to call Lyft first?
And that's what I was asking, because it don't look like these girls did anything. They just complained on the Lyft forum.
Now, when you feel violated like that, I will call the police first.
My thing is, if me and you in the car and you getting raped and I'm watching...
Now, we can't confirm that girl was watching now.
He dropped the girl off.
I mean,
Her house.
At the end of the day, we're dealing with strangers and strangers in a car.
Man, look.
Okay. Now, I did hear that Lyft has a lighter, security than Uber does. Do you know anything about that?
Well, Uber came down the pipeline.
As soon as the accusation come, they deactivated.
Well, remember, all of this, everybody got more stringent after that debacle happened in South Carolina with the girl getting killed by the Lyft driver. Mm-hmm. So after that happened, everybody went to shutdown mode. But Uber should always lead the way because Uber is older. So they're going to always probably lead the way because they're older than Lyft. So immediately Uber was like, okay, now we're doing background checks. And we're not just checking for no weed charges. Now we're checking to see what you've done in your past. So it became this thing, because I'm in a group with a lot of drivers, and it became this thing where you kept seeing messages. People were like, well, you know, I had a 20 or a 15-year-old charge. Now I can't drive for Uber anymore, you know, because this whole debacle. So Uber went into lockdown mode. Lyft, and that's what the article was saying, that Lyft is a little slower to respond. But again, Lyft, in essence, compared to Uber, Lyft is still a baby, in theory, compared to Uber.
And it's better, and they pay more, and it's more consistent.
But
I will say, because that's somebody that drives for both, I have learned that the perks with Uber are a heck of a lot better than the perks with Lyft. Like, I got stuff from Uber I did not get. And I still only scratched the surface of what I'm eligible for. So I felt that way until I started driving for Uber. And Uber's app is cleaner. Like, the direction, it gives me more of a headway. So when I accept it, it says, well, hey, you're going 30 miles south. Or, you know, this ride is only going to be, I get all those notices. With Lyft, and I noticed that today, I was like, I don't know anything. I just accept the ride, and it tells you where to go. That's all I know. Uber gives me all the details. So I actually am a fan of Uber at this point. I'm not going
to
lie.
I used to, I averaged $1,700 a week when I was driving for Lyft.
How much was you driving? Because I know I don't drive that much.
About 45, 50 hours a week.
I don't think I drive that much.
Early in the morning. I was usually driving to about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Now I go play basketball and then go home and take a nap.
Wait, when did you start?
4 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
I'm not. I got a solution.
Warehouse drivers. For that. But like I told you, that amp, everybody wants that light. And you can't get that light until you do 1,500 rides with Lyft. Just put a camera in it.
No, it's less than that because I got one of those lamps I don't even use. I can assure you, I didn't do no 1,500 rides.
Or 500 rides or something like that.
It's some minute number.
I know it's a five. I know it's a five in there.
I can assure you, I didn't drive no.
But put a camera in it. If it's that serious and mad people keep getting raped in your car, like, put a camera.
But why not? Like, here's a real solution. Okay, why don't we have segregated, like, gender segregated drivers? We put women. Women, you want
to... No, because women not going to like that, and women going to complain. And that's not a shot at women.
You may have to wait longer, because you...
Exactly, they may not...
She got to do her makeup.
So you got to wait 2 hours for a woman to...
You know, I
got
to be cute to do left. No, you don't.
And as I've heard on both ends, as a customer riding, like, I do prefer Uber, because it just seems like... I don't know, everything was just better. Just the interaction, everything was just better. The app, everything. The person I got, everything. But then on the flip side, I've heard about the driver. Like, some drivers drive with some protection in case the customer may come at them. But end of the day,
well, like
that's
a pistol?
Yeah, that's how I got.
That's, I don't know. That's, no, no, that's I don't
how.
Know.
Look, that's and look, I ain't scared. I ain't scared to tell my story. But that's how I initially got. That's how I got deactivated from Lyft.
What, for carrying a piece?
Yeah, dude tried to rob me, pulled really? The joint out on me, put it right behind my seat, and was like, "Yo, you gonna have to get out the car." And I opened the door, and he got out the car, and seen I had the hammer.
Oh, man.
Like, my boy, I don't play like that. And Lyft and Uber has a rule. It does not matter. You cannot have a weapon in your car when you're doing Uber and Lyft. So if I get shot in my car, I can't even defend myself. If I get, because we've seen that. People got that Lyft drivers, women getting beat up, getting their car taken. If they had protection in their car, it'll be totally different. The problem is that people are so scared now. Like, everybody just scared. Like, they just soft.
Safe space.
I wouldn't call soft. It soft. I mean, it's just...
The thing about being in your car and the thing about having a gun in your car is that... And the law tell you this. Your car is an extension of your house. So I can have guns in my house. And if I need protection in my car, I can have guns in my car as long as they're registered to me and I'm registered to carry. I can have a gun in my car. I can't get out my car and carry my gun if I'm not licensed as a concealed carrier. You can't do that. But if I'm in my car and you get in my car and you threaten me, I need to be able to defend myself. And Lyft and Uber got rules against being able to defend yourself in the car. Like, if somebody attack you in your car, you can't hit them back.
That's a rule?
That's an automatic deactivation. You can't combat somebody that's in your car that attacks you with aggression. It don't make sense. And that's why a lot of people don't like Lyft. I mean, don't like Uber, because if you defend yourself, you're automatically deactivated. They'll tell you, well, you should have contacted the authority. I got beat up already. What you mean, contact the authorities?
They probably ran.
Lip bleeding. Like.
So it sounds like you might need to deactivate it anyway if people keep attacking you.
That's what I'm saying. I told him, I know him. So if you drive your car looking like this,
I don't be looking like this
at night.
Wait, I don't be looking like this.
When, he probably don't.
I
care.
Don't. No, when I used to drive, but my thing is like when I'm, I know how I am as a rider. Don't talk to me. I don't want to
really?
Talk to you.
I love the chit chat.
Nah, see? I don't like small talk. Huh? Don't small talk me. I'm going down the street.
I mean, there lies in my problem with them.
I mean, you're in their car.
These things are, but
you.
I apply.
That's all I'm saying.
I apply these things across the board. I do not like chit chat. That's why I don't like trying to talk to people in the club, because that's small talk. First of all, this music way too loud for me to be trying to listen to what you're saying. And I like this song, Get Out My Ear. And you just spit on my neck. Get out my ear. Like, don't do that.
My goodness.
And if we in a car and I'm riding, the first thing I do when I sit down is put my headphones on. So imagine if I'm a driver, mm-hmm. and you get in the car, you put your headphones on, and I'm trying to talk to you, and you just ignoring me. Now I'm upset. Now I'm gonna pull up to your crib. I'm gonna kick your door in and do something crazy because that's what happens.
Because you're crazy.
No, but I'm saying that's not what that equals. That is what happened. No. That has happened multiple times across the country. A dude got ignored. He was trying to talk to the girl.
The driver.
Yeah, he got ignored
by the chick.
He was like trying to small talk her, and he didn't know she had headphones in. Mm-hmm. So he dropped her off. And she get out the car, he kick her door in, beat her up, get back in the car and leave.
Anger issues. That's not normal.
And that ain't the first time, but it's happened across the board. Women doing the same thing, like cutting dudes and stuff. These stories, you join one of them forums on Facebook. You get see them stories.
Yeah, they
them
do. Stories I'm in that group. Hilarious.
Hilarious.
But we're going to put this on ice because we'll be going for 30 years. And we have a guest in the studio.
Right?
So we
gonna and she ain't shoot. Even going. And you don't even understand. You don't even know me, do you?
We just started talking, so we started chit chatting. You saw how that worked?
No, I don't small talk. So my friend, my friend Latoya, hit me in the chat. It's like, yo, my friend, she write children books. Can you get on the show?
Oh, that's right. He did come. You came by way of him.
Oh,
so
okay.
I hit Ricardo, like, yo, I just looked at, like, I looked the stuff up and I seen it. Yo, reach out to her. She write books. He was like, do she really write books? Because that's him. That's how he do. So I sent him your information, and he checked it out, and then he told me you were going to be here. So I was like,
it was cute. I want you to get into it. All right, so we're going to segue over.
But it's all good, though. You ain't know. It's cool.
For
it's
today. Okay. Oh, shouts out to Latoya.
Thank you.
She's your publicist, right?
Yes.
Shouts out to Latoya for your publicist for getting this to happen. So we're going to segue to you now. So you are a children's book author, correct?
Correct.
All right, so tell us about that.
You're like, tell us about and that. What about it? Okay, so I wrote my first children's book, which is Buddy the Bear, and it just really started because I just wanted to create something for kids, like a manual to help them go to bed at night, and I decided to make a fun story out of it, and that's where Buddy the Bear came from, and I handed it to family and friends, and they loved it, and they were like, is there another book? And I was like, there sure can be. So I got back to writing, and we got the next Buddy Goes to School. So just wanted to create a fun character. Now it's turned into a brand.
So you don't have kids?
No, I don't.
But surprise. You write children's books.
Yes, there's a lot. Dr. Seuss, like, you can look. There's a lot of people who write books that don't have kids.
Okay, now, with writing children's books, we have authors all the time. But there is a difference between a children's author and a regular author because your books has illustrations in it.
Correct.
So who drew them? You?
No, Ovidiu Toma, so he's in Romania.
Wait, what? Wait, what? How does that happen?
2019, come on. You can
Romania, though? I can see
world.
If you said North Dakota, they don't have anything else to do, but Romania?
Yeah, have you heard of Fiverr.com?
Yes. Yeah.
Anyone? Mm-hmm. That's how I found him. So you can find people all over the world, and I checked out his artwork, and I loved it, and we've been going ever since. Strong, still, to this day. You look really confused right now. I mean, Romania really thinking for a loop.
I did not expect you to say that. Like, I thought
black people going to get mad. So you couldn't find nobody black to do it?
Right. Well, I'm working with an animator now, and he is black, so.
All right, so you have to space this out because that you're making this story very simplistic, but it can't be that simplistic because I just wrote a book last year and that process alone was atrocious. So
really,
I mean, it wasn't terrible. It's just then I'm picky and I'm a perfectionist, so that probably didn't help.
I had to learn how to let go.
You know, ultimately I end up doing that, but you know. For a children's book, though, that process has to be different. Like, for me, I just took this stuff out of my dissertation, made it user-friendly, got somebody to do the book cover, and I'm going to call it a day. You had to come up with ideologies about kids, and especially when you don't have any. I think that's what really makes this story more interesting for me, that you don't have kids, mm-hmm. and you write children's books. So who had to be your inspiration to write this book? You had to have some child, little Timmy or
nieces.
Somebody.
Nieces, yes, for sure, for sure. I have nieces that, you know. You know, as growing up, and surprise, I was a kid once. Did anybody know that? I was a kid once. So, you know, I know something about being a kid.
Okay, now you see, you keep playing around. You got to tell your age because then that segues me to something else.
31.
Okay, well, this generation, and I'll say our, that this generation and our generation are not the same. So by light years. So
you born in what, 96?
That's right.
Dang.
So everybody gonna shout out their age real quick, Kyle. We got
I'm not
because
I'm old.
Come on.
I'm not because I'm old. I'm 30. No, we're not doing that.
You got 30?
23.
23,
oh,
baby.
And Toya what, like 32?
Oh my God, Keith's a baby.
32.
We're not babies. We're men.
Oh, no, he's 22. Oh,
Keith is a baby. Keith is 22.
So you're not gonna participate?
I am 39. I'll be 40 on Halloween.
You look good.
Thank you. But the, thank you. But the point is,
I'm older than I look.
But my thing to you is, it can't be that simplistic because these kids are so different. And especially getting a child to read in the age of electronics where kids play more with electronics, because I have twins, and the twins, they play with electronics. Getting them to read, their mom can get them to read, but they play with electronics more than anything else, or they'll watch TV. My niece and my nephew, that's all they do. I cannot name one book, and my sister's going to crucify me for this. I can't name one book that my niece and nephew could recite when they were kids, because my sister would primarily put them in front of TV. Because that's, you know, what they do. So conceptualizing all of that and writing a book, it's not that simple. So you got to paint this better than that for me.
I've always had an imagination. Okay. Always have. You know, being creative. So either you have it or you may have to learn to have it or you don't have it at the end of the day. But I've always had a wild imagination. So, you know, writing and, I don't know, it just comes to me. I enjoy it. It's fun.
I mean, writing a kid's book is fun?
Yes.
Well, somebody without
fun.
Kids, that is funny
because,
to me.
Because with children, this is why I love going to a classroom. Like, you know, you read to adults, they may be like looking at what I'm wearing or something like that, right?
More than likely,
but
yes.
Kids are just into you and your energy, and they just feed off the story. You know, I don't know if y'all ever heard kids talk, but they talk about some wild stuff. Like,
yeah,
nothing's happening, but it's like a whole situation going on.
Yeah, they get it.
Yeah, my daughter 5, so I know what that conversation like. I don't be knowing what she talk about, but it's like, bet. For real? That's crazy.
Yeah.
Like, toddlers are like the best. Like, between 2 and 4, where they trying to,
I hate that age.
Where they trying to, like, get their words, but they don't really got them yet. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I'm like, hold on. What? Bet. Cool. For real? She did. Like, but she hit you? Oh, that's crazy. Made me pull up on her daddy. Like, you don't really know what's happening in the conversation, but you listening. So I get it. I get it, but I'm also confused about, like, because a lot of people that write children's songs, they don't be having kids. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, how you even get to a place where you like, you know what? I like kids enough. I could do this.
Who doesn't automatically like kids? I love kids. Oh, we got handrails. You got an automatic.
I got one, but I don't like everybody.
I like
kids.
Babies. I don't like kids.
You
know, I like babies.
I don't like everybody kids.
I don't like
kids.
You don't like all that talking going on.
I don't like the... Now our conversation has changed. So when you were a baby, you needed me for everything. Now the conversation has changed. So now I have to explain to you, or you feel like I should explain to you why I do what I do or what I'm doing every 5 minutes. I don't want to do that because I'm still the adult. I don't want to have to tell you what I'm doing every 5 minutes, and I don't have to answer your questions every 2 minutes. Mm-hmm. So, no, I don't like kids. I like babies. I don't like kids. And mine are 6, and I...
And, you know, I don't have kids, so maybe that's why I have so much energy just to give out, you know?
Okay, wait. Occupation-wise, what were you doing when you wrote this book?
Supply chain planner.
What?
Still, I still answer this.
Come on, Victoria. Like, work with me.
What is the problem,
I'm trying
guys?
To get
what
there.
What is the problem?
You work with, you working like, you have a job.
And I'm still fun at my job.
You have a job. And you... Segue that to write a children's book.
Yes, and my coworkers, like, they're my friends, like, they are very supportive of it. You know what I mean? Like, they have their job, but then they just enjoy the spirit. As an adult, you still like that, like, yeah, you go for it. You do it. You know what I mean? No? Eyebrow raise? Okay.
I mean,
my coworkers support me.
I get it.
And love
I'm
the
just,
stories.
I get it. I'm just kind of like, okay, I get it. All right, so you decide that you want to write a children's book.
Yeah.
So what was the first thing you did? Because the goal for today is if anybody is aspiring to write children's books on that level, you know, the thought process and how that works. So that's kind of the goal.
So I'm going to tell you that you're not the first person to be like, but you ain't got no kids. You got kids, what? You know. But it's something, and once you start doing something and you feel like it's for you, you have a feeling. You know what I mean? And it's not something that is going to die, or, you know, someone may say something. You may be like, I mean, I guess, maybe. but you're going to stick on that track. So what I started doing first was just writing, right? And I didn't want to share just because you have an idea of what people may come up against you about. Like, you already know. Like, I knew I was going to get that question at some point. I wasn't expecting it, like, the next day. But, you know, it'll come. And getting past that, and once I put it out there, I enjoyed it. And once I got to the kids, and you see, because that's really who it's for. You know what I mean? It's for the children. And it's just bigger than that. When I go out and I read, it's representation. You know, they see someone, you know, that may look like them, female, you know, African-American, that they're like, oh, wow, maybe I'll be an author. Maybe something they haven't even thought about before. So it's more than just, like, writing a children's book for me.
Okay.
So you like that? Thank you.
Go. Please spare me. Please spare me. Okay, so you write a book.
I wrote it. Okay, just to give some little what I did. So I wrote it, and then I had to go out and find an illustrator. So I went on Fiverr.com, and I went through some other buddies. I'm going to tell you, I went through some scary butt-looking Buddy the Bears at first. I got a little...
Why Buddy, though? What made you come with Buddy? Like, I was like, Buddy the Bear.
Well, he was a bear, and it's catchy. It's your buddy. It's your pal. It's your friend. You
Nobody
know
ever
mean?
Wrote a book called Buddy the Bear?
Yeah, but that's getting into trademarking. So you have to look at what did that bear look like and, you know, all of that just to... but they let their trademark expire. I don't want to go too far into that because I don't want them to try to... you know, re-up on me.
But as a segue, you do want to check. If you have an idea, you want to check that idea, make sure it's not out there. If it is out there, do some research because you may find that something lapsed and the opportunity may present itself.
Exactly.
That was a sidebar for people who are thinking about doing a business. Always research and make sure that business is not being used.
Yep.
Or that name is not being used because that's the worst thing. And I always use the example of McDonald's and McDowell's. You know, you have McDonald's, Golden Arches, everybody recognizes. You have a McDowell that comes out and the arch is slightly thinner. You got to be careful.
Yep, because that's how Johnny Gill owned
your logo.
That's how Johnny Gill owned the name.
Mm. Oh, and
for New Edition.
Maxine and Terry and Cindy own in Vogue, and Don and Maxine can't use it because they went to court and got it. They fought for it. So all those four of them were in Vogue and started together. It's about what's written in the courts and what's documented at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. But I digress.
Yeah, I got that trademark in there. Don't you worry. So we good. but so wrote it, went to Fiverr, got an illustrator. So I'm really creative, right? But I needed an editor just to make sure everything flowed correctly, right? Because in my brain, it looks like everything ties in correctly, but there's an editor that's like, no, we need to work in this transition. And then I go back and rewrite it.
I'm not gonna lie, I would never have thought about an editor for a children's book. Because the literature of it, the writing of it, I just figured it'd be so simplistic, you'd be okay.
No.
Huh. Mm-mm. About that.
Not at all. So yeah, I'll probably go through 3 rounds of editing because as I illustrate, I may change the story a little bit. So then I'll send it back through again. So it's not as, and a lot of people say it's a children's book. Just throw some pictures and words in there and call it a day.
I'm not even going to lie. I was kind of thinking that. I'm not even going front. I was kind of like, oh, well, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't think it was easy, but I didn't think it'd be complicated. It was like, okay, well, you know, you draw some bears running around and.
Yeah, because now that I'm thinking about it, like.
Some stuff.
It do sound like you could just, like, because I read the story on Dr. Seuss, like, with Redfish, Bluefish. Like, he wrote that story one time, and all they did was edit the pictures a bunch of times. Mm. I ain't never heard nobody, like, editing the story.
Mm-hmm. And then changing the...
Because it's not done.
It's like 20 pages in that book.
That's new. She different.
That's not like a thin book. That's like a real book. So you got to really turn the page and turn the page. So that's dope.
Mm-hmm.
How difficult was that? Like, I got to do this again? Like, the story ain't right yet?
So the whole story doesn't change, but you may think like, okay, visually, or like you said, the illustrations, I may, after the book is done, I may decide like, I want to add in a page to show what I said visually, right? To just add more dimension to the book.
All right. Put a pin there real quick. We're going to take a break real quick. When we come back, we have more with our very special guest, Ms. Victoria Allen, on the Leadership Learning with the host, Ricardo D. Rice.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared?
where do we go?
Come here.
Say it, spit it out. What is it exactly? Your pain is the amount cleaning you out. Am I satisfactory? Today I'm thinking about the things that are deadly. The way I'm drinking you down, like I wanna drown, like I wanna end me. Step on the glass, staple your tongue. Bury a friend, try to wake up. Cannibal class, killing the sun. Bury a friend, I wanna end. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Listen.
Keep you in the dark. What had you expected? Me to make you my art and make you a star and get you connected. I'll meet you in the park. I'll be calm and collected. But we knew right from the start that you'd fall apart, cause I'm too expensive. Your talk would be something that shouldn't be said out loud. Honestly, I thought that I would be dead by now. Calling security, keeping my head held down. Bury the hatchet or bury your friend right now. The debt that I owe, gotta sell my soul. Cause I can't say no, no, I can't say no. Then my limbs are frozen, my eyes won't close. And I can't say no, I can't say no.
Careful.
Step on the glass, staple your tongue. Bury a friend, try to wake up. Cannibal class, killing the sun. Bury a friend, I wanna end. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me?
All right, buddy, we are back on this Friday edition of the Leadership Blend with your host, Ricardo Rice, my correspondent.
Double R.
And the intern.
Solo Dolo.
And yep. Our very special guest.
Victoria Allen.
All right, hey. So when we left, we were, I don't know what they were talking about. They
Ricardo was hating.
Out. I don't know what.
Ricardo was hating.
They name a dumb cartoon
you are
theme song.
You are about to get the flames on social media.
That the best Pokemon. Theme song is DuckTales.
It's Pokemon.
Everybody know
top
that.
Top two.
Hand down.
Can I
no,
hear it?
It's top five. It's what top five. Because so I don't think that DuckTales theme song is better than Darkwing Duck theme
actually,
song.
Yeah. Actually, you know who beat both of them? Tailspin. Tailspin beat all of them.
Uh-uh. Darkwing Duck got it. Darkwing Duck. I ain't going to. Man, look, man. Don't get me started. But look, Arthur got it. Arthur got it.
I never even like Arthur. I
you are
there.
Tripping.
I can't get
listen, it's about
so you telling me
people. Okay?
You tell, like.
Animal. Arthur was an artwork.
You can say Arthur any way. You can sing the song. You can rap it. You can randomly start saying
you know what?
It in
okay,
church.
I'll give you that. So the next time you're in the
every
studio,
day,
the next time you're in the studio,
when you're walking down the street, and everybody dad you, like you can do it.
I'm never seen this.
And I say, hey,
loving this. Right
what a wonderful kind of day, like.
I'm creeped out. Well,
you can learn to work and play and get along with each other.
Okay, anyway, back to the guest. I don't know.
You got to listen to your heart.
Oh, my God. Back to the guest.
Oh, my
God. So
this is
we,
amazing.
When we left, we were talking about getting finding the illustrator.
Hey.
We'll sing that later.
Yo, let me know when you're ready to get the theme song for Buddy the Bear. I got you.
Ooh, I do.
All right, so back to where you were.
Okay, sorry. So we wrote it a few times. We were talking about was that frustrating? Not really, but a little bit, because sometimes you just want to be done, but, you know, you want to do a good job, so, and that's one thing, I want the rush, but it's okay to take your time, you know?
How many pages is in each book? Is it that many? It's a children's book.
42.
In a book?
For children.
Yeah.
On a children's
now
book.
Now you got pictures.
So,
you know, because, you know, back and forth a little bit. So don't, and then my next book's about 50-something. I want to.
It's a book. You said
how long? Now, Now, the kids need to read, okay, because it helps with their attention span as well, okay? And they need to learn how to focus, right?
You can barely find an adult that'll read a 42-page book, let alone a kid.
Yes, sir.
Well, children read Harry Potter books, and those are
no, those are not children.
But children do read it, though.
Those Thank are not you. Children. Those are teenagers.
Thank you. Those are long.
Those are teenagers. We to my kids.
Five, six. How many pages do you think a 5-6-year-old? Maybe, these kids are like.
Maybe 20.
But minutes. You got to think, these little iPads and all that stuff, they can handle it.
Yeah, I mean, they I guess can this do is it. A digital book. So you have digital copies of the book?
I do.
I mean, I guess if it's a digital book and they press the screen and it automatically turns the page, I mean, yeah, I guess we get there. But 42 pages for a kid's book?
It's not that long.
I gotta see this book.
It's not that long. It's only like a couple sentences per page.
Can I see the pictures?
Of course. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I just ran in here, but I got you.
I'm
Look
concerned.
At everything.
I'm
the original paperback of Bambi has 272 pages.
Uh-oh. Nobody's ever read Bambi.
Facts.
Everybody watches the movie.
Facts.
Everybody watches the movie. I don't know what you pulling that up
You
for.
Do know that I own the original Disney collection of every single Disney book. Bambi, Beauty and the Beast.
And you think you're the status quo?
I own them. I own them.
And you think you're the status quo?
Try to find it right now. I bet you it's a couple hundred dollars.
They're realizing my point. You're an anomaly. You're not the status quo.
And I have the full Britannica encyclopedia.
Well, ask the children's author. Do you have one of those? Exactly. They're like,
I got.
I
got Milan, Lion King.
Actually, for all those people that are watching the IBNX Radio Network live and are watching it from my Facebook page, please comment if you actually own any Disney book that's 200 or 300 pages, like Bambi or Dumbo.
No, I said the original Bambi story is 272 pages. Mm-hmm. The original story, Disney shortened it. So I think it's only 46 pages in that book.
Which is the version we got? Yeah, so I know what you brought that up.
The Disney version is 46 pages.
Who has that?
I do.
And my point to you is you're not the status quo.
But she's saying 40 pages. If you're just talking about pictures, you're not talking about like a paragraph worth of words per page.
We're talking about Bambi. How old is Bambi?
Now? Maybe 30?
There lies in my point. When
the original Bambi or the Disney version of Bambi?
Either one.
The Disney version of Bambi is about 96?
No, it's older.
95? No, because Lion King is 95.
Lion King is decades older than Bambi. Bambi's old.
The original story of Bambi is 19. What did it say?
You should have known I was coming for you, so you should have all these facts.
I wasn't ready either. I got quiet over here. I'm like, don't come for me.
So it's multiple. it's multiple stories of Bambi. So you got the classic Animal Tales of Bambi, which is which was rewritten in 2013. But the original version of this is called Bambi: A Life in the Woods, a novel by an Australia author that created the story named Felix, and that came out in 1923. It's 222 pages, and it's a children's book.
When was it written?
In 1923.
Oh, see,
there
point.
You go. Yeah.
In that time, you didn't have TV. So, of course, you can read a 200-page book.
But
you can't do anything
Disney's,
else.
Disney's version of this book, the original paperback of Bambi: A Life in the Woods from 1923 is $1,800. That's crazy.
No,
but
that sounds about right.
The Disney version of the Bambi story is 30 years old. And that book is 40 pages.
In my point.
So what are you saying? Like now the kids can't handle?
You saying kids is dumb?
42 pages?
You just going to insult the kids?
What?
You calling kids dumb?
That has nothing to do with their mental capacity. It's about their attention span.
What about the accelerated readers out there?
Again, we're talking about the status quo. Y'all keep pulling anomalies. We're talking about the status quo. The kids that go into Walmart and beg their parents for a leapfrog electronic toy that does something crazy. The kids that are sitting home watching TV all day, those are the status quo. Y'all are pulling anomalies. That's my point, but I digress. But we're getting off you. I digress.
But 40 pages isn't a lot.
I agree with you. It is not.
Because you're not putting
right.
If it's illustrations, then no. But I
if you're talking about three,
to,
if you're talking about three sentences per page.
That's what I'm saying. But if it's like that, then fine. I thought when she said 40 pages, I thought it was like content. On each page, I'm like,
even if you did half a paragraph per page, like that's not a lot of words.
For a kid, it's a lot of words. For a generation,
it depends. It literally depends on the font. So if I put what would seem to be half a paragraph in 24,
what size font is
Oh my gosh, y'all, like, it's large. Look, font. It's that's large what I'm saying.
If you talk about, if you talk about like 34, you talking about
like, information still, so we get into stuff.
You talking about like 34 inch font on a per page.
I mean, her book is fine because she said it's not all like words. So her book is fine. I'm just saying, you got into the Bambi thing about 200 something pages. I'm just like, bruh. But people would read it then because they didn't have anything else to do. The only option is you read or you go outside or go to sleep. Most kids are not going to sleep. And depending on the time of day, you're not going to go outside. So the only option you have is to read. So you'll read a 200 pages.
But I don't, you read it fast. I don't think that children's attention span is that bad. I think that we think that their attention span is that bad. Mm-hmm. If you don't provide them something to do, I'm bored. Even when I was doing stuff, I was bored.
But your first instinct is not going to be pick up a book.
Nah, my mama was different.
Your mom is a teacher. So, we're moving on.
But that's what I'm saying. If it's not applied in your parents, of course it won't be applied in the children. Like, if you were born in 2000, I doubt, like, I feel bad for your life. If you wasn't born in the 90s, if you wasn't born when Toy Story 2 came out, I feel bad for you. I personally feel bad for you because now there is no reason for you to pick up a book because it's all electronic. But what's so good about having something electronic is what you was about to get into with the animation. Mm-hmm. If I can create something that you can look at and still read and it's fun to read, because that's what they did when they reintroduced a lot of those Disney stories. They created the animation apps where you can download the app for that particular story and it will read like a book. The pages would turn for like, mm-hmm. My daughter used to download all that little stupid stuff. That's where PBS get a lot of their money from. A lot of their stories are like that. The little tiger, the little girl that be speaking Spanish.
Dora?
No, that's not, no. It's a, they got their own little version of that.
They stole Dora?
Nah, it's, she like in a group. I forgot the name of the, it, they like what they do is they get into books, like they get into the story and then try to solve the story.
Oh, mm-hmm. Super Friends Wild,
bro. Yeah,
Super
yeah.
Friends
Wild.
Mm-hmm. It's cute,
but bro, like mm-hmm. that. But okay, they not dude. Black. You black. We need that animation. Oh, yeah. I need to do that theme song.
We get back into you.
But it's all into preference. It's your preference, right? Mm-hmm. Some kids may like 40
pages
look at,
is too much for him.
I got a question.
Yes.
Are you gonna make a theme song?
Yeah, I got
yes,
it. I already
yeah,
got it.
Yeah,
I did it.
Yeah,
already.
I mean, but I'm open to hear more. It's not in stone yet.
No, I got it already.
I'm excited.
Okay, so what are the lessons that Buddy, using characters, children's characters teach stuff?
Right.
So what is Buddy known for? Like, what does he teach?
So in every story, he has a problem, right? It's a challenge. He has to solve that issue, but it happens through his imagination. So he goes to different places. So in the first book, he goes to space. The second book, he goes to the desert. So I wanted to, when I created the book, I wanted to be where the kids were reading, but they were learning something at the same time. So some parents will say, my kid wasn't even thinking about the stars and out of space, but now they're talking about rocket ships and everything like that. So it expands their imagination. So that's what I want to do with Buddy in every single book.
So Buddy has parents that are in part of the book and stuff?
Yes, yes.
What's his parents' name?
Mama Bear, Big
oh,
Bear,
good.
Angela and Antoine. Come on.
Y'all want to name the bands? What y'all want the band? The Mama. You say Angela and Antoine.
Yep.
I figured you would name the parents. I was okay. Well, Mama Bear. Okay.
Deshaun
Mama
and Tiffany.
In your house, you can name the bears whatever you would like.
Does he have siblings?
He will soon.
Are you writing siblings?
Yeah. We're going to continue on. I mean, getting a younger sibling is tough, right? Well, I'm the baby of my family, so I don't know.
Me too.
I'm the oldest, so I know.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, I know what they went through. But, you know, sharing. So in the second book, he has a problem that has a friend that has a problem. He can relate. He helps his friend solve the problem. So we got some good stuff in that book. We got some good stuff. Not just a bunch of words and pictures.
Okay. Okay.
Learning lessons.
I'm just glad you're black, cause
what?
A lot of the look at children's authors, they don't look like us for real. It's a few of them out there. Like a girl I went to school with, she writes books, and writes children's books. It's not a lot of like children's authors that's like black.
So where can people get your book? Do they just get it online, or they can get it from the normal store?
So buddythebearbooks.com, so that's the official website, and then you can get on Amazon as well, and then you can get on walmart.com, so it's pretty much online right now. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to touch on your point about how there's not a lot of black authors out there. So when I go out, I meet a lot of people that say, you know, I want to write a children's book, I want to write a book, but they just never did. They don't really know how. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I like say, you know, reach out to me. We can get it done. I am one of those people. If you reach out to me, I will reach back, by the way. But to get more authors out there. So that's why I'm here.
So what are you've gone through the process. Why do you think that is so? I mean, outside of people just not being motivated enough to do it.
Yeah.
What other hardships would they face? Based on your experience, if you had any, you might have been fortunate enough to just do it. But what, you know, from you, because you travel with the book,
right?
So you've seen different venues and stuff. So what would you think they would come up against that might deter them from actually being able to execute writing a children's book? Because we talk to a normal author. You know, normal authors are like, you know, you hit distribution issues. Which the funny thing is, self-publishing used to be the underdog. Now everybody does it. So it's rare to find somebody who doesn't write like a professional book have a publisher, because most people just self-publish because it's easier and it's less money. So, you know, anything you could think of that might...
So I'm self-published, so that means that I have to do it all myself, right? So it's a lot of work. You know, I make it or break it, right? But, you know, Toya goes out and helps, gets me these opportunities. People see your information, right? And you have to get yourself out there and put yourself out there, because I'm actually a shy person, right? Believe it or not, stop it.
I don't know.
You know, like, it was a process of finding my voice, right? And being comfortable and putting myself out there and being, you know, realizing that what I'm doing is beyond me, right? If I'm not out there, someone may, you know, I don't know. We got some people who want to see pictures and talk more about illustration or writing a book, so it's just, I don't understand, it's bigger than me. And get over, like, rejection. Every time I show my face, people aren't just excited and like, hey, you know, come read all my kids. But when I get the opportunities that I do, it's so worth it. So right. I get a lot of no responses or, you know, when I say when you reach out to people, they don't hit you back. But I keep moving. You find your group, like you find your supporters, like you find your readers. You know, it's not for everybody, and that's everything in life, right? As an artist, you have your fans, the people that enjoy you, got your critics. But at the end of the day, I'm sharing with the world my gift.
They just be hating, because J.K. Rowling is not attractive.
Nobody cares what she looks like. Like Harry Potter.
You ain't never seen them videos of J.K. Rowling. Hold on, but real talk, you ain't never seen that video of her at a book reading, and she read the book. It is not like a pleasant video to watch. It's like, cause she read the book like as the character, so she like doing the push. It's like a lot. I'm like, well, how you know how all these?
I
people
had to watch that. I mean, she as soon as I leave, I'm watching.
It's
that.
Funny, but the fact like. Because it's different with, like, children's books reading. Because you assume that you can get anybody to read a children's book and kids is going to enjoy it. Nah, kids is critics. Right. So they'll be looking at you like, hey, Carl, let's go get these blocks. Like, let's go get these blocks. This ain't the one right here. Kids are honest, man. I just showed you the video of the little girl. Like,
my question is, why would somebody record that and then put it up there?
Because like, that is hilarious. You see the video of the little girl getting her hair braided?
No.
So the lady stopped and she said, what's wrong with you? You okay? No, ma'am. What's wrong with you? I don't like sitting down here. It stank. She's sitting between the lady's legs. And the lady
just caught that.
That's embarrassing.
I just caught that.
Yo, that's embarrassing. She said, you ain't even have to do me like that. I'm almost done with your head now. Why you ain't been saying nothing? I don't know. It don't smell that bad. I know I'm a little rank. I'm about to go take a shower, but you know, I used to change you when you was a baby. I'm like, they don't got nothing to do with this girl saying that is a little funky. Sitting with that.
I just caught what she was saying.
Hilarious.
I just caught that. Okay, so what would be your advice to aspiring children authors? People that really say, I have a love for kids. I really would love to do this. But for whatever reason, what would be your advice to them?
I hate to say it, cause if, but you really have to believe in yourself at the end of the day. That's if you're doing it to get some type of recognition or to, you know, prove to somebody that you can do it, you're not doing it for the right reasons, right? So if it's your passion, you stick with it, you believe in yourself. And everyone, I tell people, we all have a story to tell. You never know who may be inspired by it or, you know, your testimony or what you have going on. I can do it. You can do it. We all can do it. You just got to believe yourself and go for it. Period.
Okay.
All right, and Fiverr.com. So, you really, know, really, Fiverr.com. Yeah, you know.
How does that even work? How does that even, I looked at Fiverr, but I've never actually used it. So how does that actually work?
It's dope.
So it's just a site where you can just go in there and see, like, a gallery of everybody's work. So you can get everything on there, illustrating, editing, resume writing. It's just where everybody pretty much puts all their gifts all over the world on the website. And you can give reviews and see, you know, so I always look at reviews and what other people have had to say. So I just want to say that because a lot of people give, like, this motivational comment, but they don't tell you where you can go to actually get some work done. And then also I just surround myself with people, you know, have a team, have Toya out here helping me push the word on the book. Just always being thankful for everybody who gives me the opportunity because, you know, y'all are helping me make my dream come true, man. Y'all gonna make me cry.
Oh,
thank you.
That's the other, that's the Sunday show we cry. We don't cry on this.
Okay, my bad. Sunday I'm early. Show. I'm
that's
early. I'm
cry
early.
On Marissa, that's the crying show. This is the sober information show we get to it. All right, so tell everybody how to get in touch with you.
So on social media at Buddy the Bear Books. Right, and if you just want to look at me, see what I got going on, I'm at the creator Victoria, and the website again is buddythebearbooks.com.
How much do they cost?
What would you like? So we got packages. So I have the books, right? So we have the first and second book. We have the teddy bear with some pajamas.
Oh, there's a bear bear?
There's a bear bear. There's a teddy
man,
bear
there's a
bear.
Bear.
Hey, because it's one? Because. I got you. It's all about creating an experience, right? So it's beyond just reading a book. You can have the teddy bear that goes along with the book. Like I said, we work on an animation.
Wait, so how did you do that? So how did you get that taken care of?
The, like, teddy bear?
Yeah, because that's a Buddy the Bear. Mm-hmm. So how'd you do that?
Alibaba.com.
That's a thing?
Yeah, so you could talk to manufacturers, right, overseas. That so how, just real quick, I don't want to take show for forever. But, so, I sent pictures of Buddy the Bear, and it was a process of tweaking it and being like, okay, that look like Buddy, or that don't look like Buddy, and just getting it done. So
is it expensive? That's a yes. You took too long.
No.
When I say expensive, ain't less than $500.
Yeah, for a prototype, yes.
What about for distribution?
And that's another thing. So,
this is what I was trying to get you to
okay,
get into.
Okay. But when I first started, I was doing a lot of middleman, like talk to, you know, different middlemen. So they add on a charge, mm-hmm. right? Nothing against middlemen. Y'all got a job to do. They do simplify the process. But now I'm talking directly to manufacturers to get the bear done instead of going through middlemen. That's why it cuts down the cost. Mm. So always remember that when you're doing it. Take some more research. But Alibaba.com, that's where you can find manufacturers. If you have a book out there and you want to create your, you know, character to have with your book because it adds fun and life to it, then check them out too.
So how does that work? Do they take care of when people order the bear, or you order like a box of bears and you have to distribute the bears when people order?
You order in bulk. Mm-hmm. Takes money to make money, right?
Write them a book for me. It takes money to buy a box of books. So,
but yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
All right, so finish your package. You said it was the one with the bear.
Oh, so we have the bedtime buddy. We can get Buddy the Bear in the bedtime pajamas and his bedtime story. We got back to school buddy. He has a school outfit that he wears the book. Right, this yeah. And the bedtime comes with glow-in-the-dark stars because I had glow-in-the-dark stars when I was little. They're still cool, don't you think so?
Yes, anyone? They are.
I'm looking at you. You're not with the glow-in-the-dark stars. You know, you're just staring like, nah, I'm with the teddy bear. But anywho, yeah. Yeah, so go check out buddybearbooks.com. See what we got. And more to come.
All right. So we
got that theme song coming.
Oh, good God. So is there a cartoon in the future for
yes, movies? Yes.
What about a movie?
Yes. A movie?
I mean,
well,
start with cartoons.
Yeah, I mean, we could talk about it. We can talk about this movie. Definitely. I'm getting it done.
I love it. I love it. Mm-hmm. All right, so everybody, for those that are aspiring to be children writers, you got it first from Miss Victoria Allen. She gave you some tips and some information as to how to get that going. Anybody else on the panel have any last words before we get out of here?
Yeah, don't play yourself, though. Don't think just because you, like, do some stuff that you like. Let children see what you do. That's the best way to get... Real talk, that's the best way to, when you're writing for kids, mm-hmm. the best thing to do is show it to children. And they'll let you know, like, from the jump. Now, I don't like that. He got a scary face. You know what I'm saying? But do that. And don't do it for the bread. Like, these arts, you can't just do it for the money. I make music. It ain't just for the money. I've been doing it for free so long that when I started getting a check, I was like, bet. So, like, you just keep going. But... I definitely, when she told me about you, I was like, yeah, we got to get on the show.
Mm-hmm. He does not do that very often. I was like, wait, and she's a children's author? Do you know her?
Thank you. You the realest. Thank you.
Well, you know, I try. I try.
Tell me any last thoughts?
No, other than just be safe during the hurricane.
Yeah, and watch who you ride with and lift.
Right. Yes,
and on
please.
That note, we're going to leave you here by on Monday, same time, same place on the Leadership Band with your host, Ricardo D. Rice.